welcome. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Together we pray. O merciful Father, I have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. I have failed to do the good you call us to do. I have done the evil you forbid. Who but you can lift our guilt? For me you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, by his holy life of love, by his innocent death, by his rising to life again, you forgive all. And you pour out your Spirit into us, breathe life. Free me to serve you with new heart, mind, and strength. As Jesus' servant, your pastor, it's my delight to give you the gift of Jesus himself. I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Ezekiel, again, we're about 650 years before Jesus, talking to people who have been taken into exile in Babylon.
The first reading, Ezekiel 18, 1 through 4, 25 through 32. The Lord spoke his word to me, he said. What do you mean when you use this proverb about the land of Israel? Fathers have eaten sour grapes, and their children's teeth are set on edge. As I live, declares the Almighty Lord, you will no longer use this proverb in Israel. The life of every person belongs to me. Fathers and their children belong to me. The person who sins will die. But you say, the Lord's way is unfair. Listen, nation of Israel, isn't my way fair? Isn't it your ways that are unfair? When a righteous person turns away from doing right and does evil things, he will die. He will die because of the evil things he has done. When a wicked person turns away from the wicked things that he has done and does what is fair and right, he will live. He realized what he was doing and turned away from all the rebellious things that he had done. He will certainly live. He will not die. But the nation of Israel says, the Lord's way is unfair. Isn't my way fair, nation of Israel? Isn't it your ways that are unfair? That is why I will judge each of you by what you have done, people of Israel, declares the Almighty Lord. Change the way you think and act. Turn away from all the rebellious things that you have done so that you will not fall into sin. Stop all the rebellious things that you are doing. Get yourselves new hearts and new spirits. Why do you want to die, nation of Israel? I don't want anyone to die, declares the Almighty Lord. Change the way you think and act. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And this is our second week, 4 weeks, four chapters in the book of the little letter of Paul to the church in Philippi, Greece.
Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by coming obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Peter. I invite you to stand as we hear good news from our Lord Jesus. He speaks to us here from Matthew chapter 21, another parable. Well, what do you think about this? A man with two sons said to the older boy, "Son, go out and work in the vineyard today." The son answered, "No, I won't go." But later he changed his mind and went anyway. Then the father told the other son, "You go." And he said, "Yes, sir, I will." But he did not go. Which of the two obeyed his father? Well, the scribes and Pharisees replied, "The first." And Jesus explained his meaning. "I tell you the truth, corrupt tax collectors and prostitutes will get into the kingdom of God before you do. For John the Baptist came and showed you the right way to live, but you did not believe him, while tax collectors and prostitutes did. And even when you saw this happening, you refused to believe John and repent of your sins." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated, friends. So we've got that phrase, talking the talk and walking the walk. What's easier to do, to talk the talk or walk the walk? talk is cheap, we say, right? It's easier to talk. Well, Jesus starts here with this little parable, and it's always astounding to me how much truth he packs into these little tiny stories. So even just looking at this part of the text, it's actually Tuesday of Holy Week. Jesus is there in the temple debating with the scholars of the scriptures, these people who are rejecting him. And in fact, 3 days they're going to be howling for his death and they're going to get his way. But even now, Jesus is challenging them and helping them to see their opportunity. So what do you think about this? Here's a man with two sons, tells the older boy, son. The word there is paidon, which means my dear little one. Dear child, it's a term of great affection. I've got my son, Ben, is 34. I call him, how's the boy? You know, he's a grown man. He's my boy, you know. So it's that kind of a thing that this dad says. Son, go out and work in the vineyard. And the son answers, I will not. Is that startling? I mean, he's been tender. Is this guy being tender in return? Just, I will not. That's just rude. And if you actually listen to him, even names where the problem is, it's a problem in his own will. Why do I got to do what you want? I got what I want to do. You're not going to tell me. I'll do what I want. I will not do what you said. But later, changed his mind and went anyway. Not going to give away the whole point of the story here, but that's actually the only thing in this story that happens. This guy changes. And I just want you to think about that for a moment. Why does this guy change? Is Jesus just telling a story? So again, put this in your own family or a family you know. So the one in authority, the mom or the dad, comes and say, hey, come and help me with this. And the kid says, no! Well, then what's the third thing that happens? It's what?
Wait till
dad comes home or, what do you mean no? There is normally a kickback from the authority, right? I didn't see this myself. It takes some Bible scholars to explain this stuff to me, but sometimes what's happening in these parables is like that's kind of the weird thing in this story. What is up with this father? How come the father doesn't say anything to him? When the son says, I will not, and he sees dad standing there mute, what does he learn about his father? Maybe dad's a pushover? Maybe he sees his father take those words in? And he sees how those words wound his father. Jesus kind of leaves us to guess. As if to challenge us. When you say no to God, what does it do to him? It does hurt him. In fact, it hurts him all the way to the blood of his son, doesn't it? Now, maybe people that don't know God would say, well, that's ridiculous. I would never say no to God. Even if I did, nothing happens. I mean, you can say no to God and not get hit by a bolt of lightning, probably, don't you think? It's a very true picture of our Heavenly Father. I will not. But I think this kid's eyes are opened and he sees that in his father. That his father, despite the son's disobedience, his father still loves him. I called you to work, you said no, okay. We're going to let that go for now. Which is what forgiveness means, to let go. Because I don't want just a worker. I can go hire a worker. What I want is a relationship. Well, he goes and he changes his mind. which is interesting because the later at the end of the story, Jesus talks about repentance, and the Greek word for repentance means to change mind. You saw things this way, you thought God was a dictator, and now you see things this way, that God is a forgiver and a strengthener and a new life giver. He changes his mind and goes anyway. Let's contrast this with the other side. He says, you go out, work in the vineyard. Says the same thing. And he says, yes, sir, I will. That's what you call talking the talk. That's a classic, right? It's almost as if he's like, you know, hustling off and grabbing the spade and the pruning hook fork and pruning hook, and he's off like, go get some grapes in the vineyard. Yes, sir, I will. Sounds so enthusiastic. But he does not go. Did he change? It says with the first son, he changed. This guy didn't change. Who is Jesus talking about? He's talking to these Pharisees and these scribes. These people say, well, obviously we're the good people in Israel. We're the ones who want to understand the scripture. We're the ones who are here debating on what's actually true, Jesus. We're the good guys. We always say yes to God. And Jesus says, yep, you always say yes to God. So? You say you love God. If it's real, how are you going to love your neighbor? Do you even really care about the eternal future of the tax collectors who give them and sold out to Rome? Do you have any care about the prostitutes living among us? Do you actually love people who are other than you? In fact, at the end of the story, Jesus actually flips and says, who are the ones that listen to John the Baptizer? So this story is written by Matthew. Remember what Matthew's previous occupation was? Tax collector. And these women that are following Jesus. I mean, the Gospels don't hide this stuff. A lot of these women had made their money in the world's toughest profession. It's not easy. But they've changed. At first they said, no, I'm not going to play religious games. It's a tough world. I've got to make my own way. But then they heard about a God who loves and forgives, and they saw it in Jesus, and they gladly followed. So, I'm tempted to ask myself, so what are you, Stephen? Are you the one who talks the talk or walks the walk? And to tell you the truth, it's not too hard to talk the talk here because you're paying me to do it. But out there, sometimes it's tougher. And as far as walking the walk, I love to do it lots of times, but lots of times I don't. The real good news of the story, again, it's always about the one who's telling the story. This Jesus, who talks this talk to us, actually walks this walk all the way. He'll take up that cross for our forgiveness. He'll rise again and put in us that new life where we can say yes to God and love our neighbor. May it be to your glory, Jesus. Amen. I'm going to invite your friends to gather hearts in prayer as soon as I share with you some of the others here that were sent in today. I continue to pray for Dave Spittler as he's healing in Ohio, heading back towards Florida. Jim Kalick is still battling shingles, praying for him. Shirley is home with Howard and continuing to heal. And Al's hoping to get home to Jim in a week or two, doing a rehab after her fracture of pelvis. Scott Heppner has us praying for his father, Bruce, who's hospitalized with cestus. And also his grandson, Lucas, who is the regular, adorable feature at our old 9 o'clock worship service here. Lucas apparently has a kidney that is failing and has to be removed. So prayers for little Lucas.
Leanne, our parish secretary, has us praying for the family of her Uncle David, as the Lord indeed did call him home. I've got the wrong day here. What day was that? I think that just happened yesterday. Ken and Diane have us praying with thanks for the birth of their new grandbaby, their grandson in Ireland, where they are visiting. Stellan Kenneth. Sheila Blindemus has praying for her friend Cindy, who's battling Bell's palsy. And it was yesterday morning, right, that Roy Williamson was called home to the Lord down in Texas. I saw Ed Rapolsky today. He's at Sarasota Memorial Healing. Should get back to his rehab pretty soon. Andy, Deanna's son, has a procedure tomorrow. And Susan Pow'r is normally with us here on Wednesday night, but it's her birthday tonight. I think she's out celebrating with her kids. So happy birthday to Susan. Those are the prayers that I'm aware of. Are there prayers that you want to add tonight? I speak them all also for the people that are going to watch us on the video later. Any other prayers? How's Pam doing? Give her our love. I don't get to talk to her enough. Okay, friends, I'm going to invite you to stand as we first speak our faith, and we'll go to the Lord in prayer and receive his gifts. We have here the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He descended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. O Lord Jesus, you, the Son of God, the beloved, the one and only, who lived in our human flesh with that perfect love for the Father, shown in your perfect love, giving yourself for your human brothers and sisters, winning for us that forgiveness, filling us with your resurrection life. Pour out on us and on all our brothers and sisters that gift of forgiveness and resurrection, that we too may talk your good news and may walk your kindness and love with those in this world in need around us, even as we walk with you to the life to come. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for this world, Lord, so often caught in pride, refusing to be helpful to one another, so often caught in dysfunction and despair, refusing to believe that you can work your good. Come, Lord. We do pray for good government and for caring caregivers, and ask your blessing on all those who bless us in so many ways. Make us also to be neighbors to those near us, that we may have the joy of an identity, your sons and daughters, that we may have the joy of your purpose, bringing the harvest in your fruitful field, that we may have the hope of knowing that all things in your good hand are for us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we come now to the fruit of this vine, as we rejoice in the gift given with this bread, we thank you, Jesus, for your body and blood poured out on the cross, and your body and blood, the risen one, come here to strengthen us in this feast. So, Lord, hear our prayers for those who are broken in their bodies, and those who seek your healing in their spirits, and those who need your new life in their families and communities. Come with your healing spirit, Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
These and all the prayers in our hearts, we lift to your throne. We pray to the Father and the Spirit's power what you have taught us to say.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus, that very night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had thanked his heavenly Father, he broke the bread, he gave it to his disciples for you, the forgiveness of your sins. It is truly good and healing that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels, with archangels, with all of our companions now in heaven, we too rejoice in your holy name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of angel armies, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, help us from the heights of heaven. He gives us bliss. He will come us in the name of the Lord. Together we give God thanks. Lord, now let your servant depart in peace, as your word promised. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, a light to enlighten the Gentiles. you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you. Be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with good favor and give you peace. Amen. Great week.